Fair Verona, where we lay our scene.
From ancient grudge break to new mutiny.
Where civil blood makes civil hands unclean.
From forth the fatal loins of these two foes.
A pair of star-crossed lovers take their life.
Whose misadventured piteous overthrows.
Do with their death bury their parents' strife.
The fearful passage of their death-marked love.
And the continuance of their parents' rage.
Which but their children's end not could remove.
Is now the 2 hours' traffic of our stage.
The which of you with patient ears attend.
What here shall miss, our toil shall strive to mend.
A dog of the house of Montague moves me.
To move is to stir. To be valiant is to stand. Therefore, if thou movest, thou runnest away. The quarrel is between our masters.
And us their men! 'Tis all on. I will show myself a tyrant. When I have fought with the men, I'll be cruel with the maids and cut off their heads.
The heads of the maids?
Aye, the heads of the maids or their maidenheads, taken in what sense thou wilt.
They must take it in sense that feel it.
Me they shall feel while I am able to stand, and 'tis known I am a pretty piece of flesh.
Oh, 'tis well thou art not fish. If thou hadst, thou hadst been poor John. Draw thy tool. Here comes two of the house of Montague.
My naked weapon is out. Quarrel, I will back thee.
How? Turn thy back and run?
Fear me not.
Nay, Mary, I fear thee.
Let us take the law of our sides. Let them begin.
I will frown as I pass by, and let them take it as they list.
Nay, as they dare. I will bite my thumb at them, which is a disgrace to them if they bear it.
Do you bite your thumb at us, sir?
I do bite my thumb, sir.
Do you bite your thumb at us, sir?
Is the law of our side if I say aye?
No.
No! Sir, I do not bite my thumb at you, sir, but I bite my thumb, sir.
Do you quarrel, sir?
Quarrel, sir? No, sir. If you do, sir, I am for you. I serve as good a man as you.
No better.
Well, sir.
Say better. Here comes my master's kinsman.
Yes, better, sir.
You lie.
Draw if you be men. Gregory, remember thy swatching blow.
Part fools, put up your swords. You know not what you do.
What? Art thou drawn among these heartless hinds? Turn thee, Benvolio. Look upon thy death.
I do but keep the peace. Put up thy sword, or manage it to part these men with me.
What? Drawn and talk of peace? I hate the word, as I hate hell, all Montagues, and thee.
What noise is this? Give me my longsword, ho!
Oh, a crutch. Why call you for a sword?
My sword, I say. Old Montague has come and flourishes his blade in spite of me. Thou villain, Capulet! Hold me not! Let me go!
Thou shalt not stir a foot to seek a foe!
Rebellious subjects! Enemies to peace! Profaners of this neighbor-stained steel! On pain of torture from those bloody hands, throw your mistempered weapons to the ground and hear the sentence of your moved prince. 3 civil brawls. Bred of an airy word, by thee, old Capulet and Montague, have thrice disturbed the quiet of our streets, and made Verona's ancient citizens cast by their grave-beseeming ornaments to wield old partisans, and hands as old, cankered with peace to part your cankered hate. If ever you disturb our streets again, your lives will pay the forfeit of the peace. For this time, all the rest apart, you, Capulet, shall go along with me. And Montague, come you this afternoon to know our further pleasure in this case to Old Freetown, our common judgment place. Once more, on pain of death, all men depart.
Who set this ancient quarrel new abroach? Speak, nephew, were you by when it began?
Here were the servants of your adversary and yours close fighting ere I did approach. I drew to part them. In the instant came the fiery Tybalt with his sword prepared, which, as he breathed defiance to my ears, he swung about his head and cut the winds, who, nothing hurt withal, hissed him in scorn. While we were interchanging thrusts and blows, came more and more and fought on part and part, till the prince came who parted either part.
Oh, where's Romeo? Saw you him today? Right glad I am he was not at this fray.
Madam, an hour before the worshipped sun peered forth the golden window of the east, a troubled mind drave me to walk abroad. where, underneath the grove of sycamore that westward rooteth from this city side, so early walking did I see your son.
Many a morning hath he there been seen, with tears augmenting the fresh morning dew, adding to clouds more clouds with his deep sighs. Away from light steals home my heavy son, and private in his chamber pens himself, shuts up his windows, locks fair daylight out, and makes himself an artificial night. Black and portentous must this humor prove, unless good counsel may the cause remove.
My noble uncle, do you know the cause?
I neither know it nor can learn of him.
See where he comes, so please you, step aside. I'll know his grievance or be much denied. Good morrow, cousin.
Is the day so young?
But news struck nine.
Aye me, sad hours seem long. Was that my father that went hence so fast?
It was. Oh, what sadness lengthens Romeo's hours?
Not having that which having makes them short.
In love?
Out.
Of love?
Out of her favor where I am in love.
Alas, that love so gentle in his view should be so tyrannous and rough in proof.
Alas, that love whose view is muffled still should without eyes see pathways to his will. Where shall we dine? Oh me, what fray was here? Yet tell me not, for I have heard it all. Here's much to do with hate, but more with love. Why then, O brawling love, O loving hate, O anything of nothing first create? O heavy lightness, serious vanity, misshapen chaos of well-seeming forms, feather of lead, bright smoke, cold fire, sick health, still waking sleep, that is not what it is. This love, feel I, that feel no love in this. Dost thou not laugh?
No, cuz I rather weep.
Good heart at what?
At thy good heart's oppression.
Why such is love's transgression? Griefs of mine own lie heavy in my breast, which thou wilt propagate to have it pressed with more of thine. This love that thou hast shown doth add more grief to too much of mine own. Love is a smoke made with the fume of sighs, being purged, a fire sparkling in lover's eyes, being vexed, a sea nourished with lover's tears. What is it else? A madness most discreet, a choking gall and a preserving sweet. Farewell, my cuz.
Soft, I will go along, and if you leave me so, you do me wrong.
Tut, I have lost myself. I am not here. This is not Romeo. He's some otherwhere.
Tell me in sadness, who is that you love?
What, shall I groan and tell thee?
Groan? Why, no. But sadly, tell me who.
Bid a sick man in sadness make his will, a word ill urged to one that is so ill. In sadness, cousin, I do love a woman.
I aimed so near when I supposed you loved.
A right good mark, man, and she's fair I love.
A right fair mark, fair cause is soonest hit.
Well, in that hit you miss. She'll not be hit with Cupid's arrow. She hath Dian's wit. And in strong proof of chastity, well armed, from love's weak childish bow she lives unharmed. She will not stay the siege of loving terms, nor bide the encounter of assailing eyes, nor ope her lap to saint seducing gold. Oh, she is rich in beauty, only poor, that when she dies, with beauty dies her store.
Then she hath sworn that she will still live chaste.
She hath, and in that sparing makes huge waste. For beauty starved with her severity cuts beauty off from all posterity. She is too fair, too wise, wisely too fair to merit bliss by making me despair. She hath forsworn to love, and in that vow do I live dead that live to tell it now.
Be ruled by me. Forget to think of her.
Oh, teach me how I should forget to think.
By giving liberty unto thine eyes. Examine other beauties.
'Tis the way to call hers exquisite in question more. These happy masks that kiss fair ladies' brows, being black, put us in mind they hide the fair. He that is struck in blind cannot forget the precious treasure of his eyesight lost. Show me a mistress that is passing fair. What doth her beauty serve but as a note where I may read who's past that pass? Passing fair. Farewell, thou canst not teach me to forget.
I'll pay that doctrine or else die in debt.
But Montague is bound as well as I in penalty alike, and 'tis not hard, I think, for men so old as we to keep the peace.
Of honorable reckoning are you both, and pity 'tis you lived at odds so long. But now, my lord, what say you to my suit?
But saying o'er what I have said before. My child is yet a stranger in this world. She hath not seen the change of 14 years. Let two more summers wither in their pride ere we may think her ripe to be a bride.
Younger than she are happy mothers made.
And too soon marred are those so early made. Earth hath swallowed all my hopes, but she is the hopeful lady of my earth. But woo her, gentle Paris, get her heart.
My will to her consent is but a part, and she agree. Within her scope of choice lies my consent and fair according voice. This night I hold an old accustomed feast, whereto I have invited many a guest, such as I love. And you, among the score, one more most welcome makes my number more. At my poor house, look to behold this night, earth-treading stars that make dark heaven light. Such comfort as do lusty young men feel when well-appareled April on the heel of limping winter treads, even in such delight. Among fresh female buds shall you this night inherit at my house. Hear all see, and like her most, whose merit most shall be, which on more view of many, mine being one, may stand in number, though in reckoning none. Huh? Come, I pray, come and crush a cup of wine.
Nurse, where's my daughter? Call her forth to me.
I bade her come. What lamb? What ladybird? God forbid, where's this girl? What Juliet?
How now? Who calls?
Your mother.
Madam, I am here. What is your will?
This is the matter. Nurse, give leave a while. We must talk in secret. Nurse, come back again. I have remembered me. Thou'st hear our counsel. Thou knowest my daughter's of a pretty age.
Faith, I can tell her age into an hour.
She's not 14.
Oh, God, bless thee. Thou wast the prettiest babe that e'er I nursed, and I might live to see thee married once. I have my wish.
Mary, that Mary is the very theme I came to talk of. Tell me, daughter Juliet, how stands your disposition to be married?
It is an honor that I dream not of.
An honor! Were not I thine only nurse, I would say thou hadst sucked wisdom from thy teat.
Well, think of marriage now. Younger than you here in Verona, ladies of esteem are made already mothers. By my count, I was your mother much upon these years that you are now a maid. Thus then, in brief, the county Paris seeks you for his love.
A man, young lady? Such a man as all the world. Why, he's a man of wax.
Verona's summer hath not such a flower.
Nay, he's a flower, in faith, a very flower.
What say you? Can you love the gentleman? This night you shall behold him at our feast. Read o'er the volume of young Paris' face and find delight writ there with beauty's pen. Examine every married lineament and see how one another gives content. And what obscured in that fair volume lies, fine written in the margin of his eyes. The fish live in the sea, and 'tis much pride for fair without the fair within to hide. This precious book of love, this unbound lover, to beautify him only lacks a cover. That book in many's eyes doth share the glory that in gold clasps locks in the golden story. So shall you share all he doth possess, by having him, making yourself no less.
No less, nay, bigger. Women grow by men.
Speak briefly. Can you like of Paris's love?
I'll look to like if looking liking move, but no more deep will I endart mine eye than your consent gives strength to make it fly.
Juliet, the county stays.
Go, girl, seek happy nights to happy days.
At this same ancient feast of Capulets sups the fair Rosaline, whom thou so lovest, with all the admired beauties of Verona. Go thither, and with unattainted eye, compare her face with some that I shall show, and I will make thee think thy swan a crow.
When the devout religion of mine eye maintains such falsehood, then turn tears to fires, and these who often drowned could never die. Transparent heretics be burnt for liars. One fairer than my love, the all-seeing sun ne'er saw her match since first the world begun.
Tut, you saw her fair, none else being by, herself poised with herself in either eye. But in that crystal scales, let there be weighed your lady's love against some other maid that I will show you shining at this feast, and she shall scant show well than now shows beast at best.
I'll go along, no such sight to be shown, but to rejoice in splendor of mine own. Give me a torch, I am not for this ambling. Being but heavy, I will bear the light.
Nay, gentle Romeo, we must have you dance.
Not I, believe me. You have dancing shoes with nimble soles. I have a soul of lead, so stakes me to the ground, I cannot move.
You are a lover. Borrow Cupid's wings and soar with them above a common bound.
I am too sore and pierced with his shaft to soar with his light feathers and so bound. I cannot bound a pitch above dull woe. Under love's heavy burden do I sink.
And to sink in it, should you burden love? Too great oppression for a tender thing.
Is love a tender thing? It is too rough, too rude, too boisterous, and it pricks like thorn.
If love be rough with you, be rough with love! Prick love for pricking, and you beat love down!
Come, knock and enter, and no sooner in, but every man betake him to his legs.
And we mean well in going to this mask, but 'tis no wit to go.
Why, may one ask?
I dreamed a dream tonight.
And so did I.
Well, what was yours?
That dreamers often lie.
In bed asleep while they do dream things true.
Oh, then I see Queen Mab hath been with you. She is the fairy's midwife, and she comes in shape no bigger than an agate stone on the forefinger of an alderman, drawn with a team of little atomies athwart men's noses as they lie asleep. Her wagon spokes, made of long spinner's legs, the cover of the wings of grasshoppers, her traces of the smallest spider's webs, her collars of the moonshine's watery beams, her whip of cricket bone, the lash of film, her wagoner, a small gray-coated gnat, not half so big as a round little worm, pricked from the lazy finger of a maid. Her chariot is an empty hazelnut made by the joiner squirrel or old grub. Time out of mind, the fairy's coachmakers. And in this state, she gallops night by night through lovers' brains. And then they dream of love, or courtiers' knees that dream on curtsies straight, or lawyers' fingers who straight dream on fees, or ladies' lips who straight on kisses dream. Which oft the angry Mab with blisters flags, because their breasts with sweetmeats tainted are. Sometime she gallops o'er a courtier's nose, and then dreams he of smelling out a suit. And sometime comes she with a tithe pig's tail, tickling a parson's nose as he lies asleep, then dreams he of another benefice. Sometime she comes o'er a soldier's neck, and then he dreams of cutting foreign throats, of breeches, ambuscados, Spanish blades, and health 5 fathom deep. And then anon, drums in his ear, at which he starts and wakes, and being thus frighted, swears a prayer or two, and sleeps again. This is that very Mab. This is she!
Peace, peace, Mercutio, peace. Thou talkst of nothing.
True. I talk of dreams, which are the children of an idle brain, begot of nothing but vain fantasy, which is as thin of substance than the air, and more inconstant than the wind.
This wind you talk of blows us from ourselves. Supper is done, we shall come too late.
I fear too early, for my mind misgives some consequence, yet hanging in the stars, shall bitterly begin his fearful date with this night's revels, and expire the term of a despised life closed in my breast by some vile forfeit of untimely death. But he that hath the steerage of my course, direct my sail. On, lusty gentlemen!
Strike drum!
Yes, welcome! Welcome, gentlemen! Ladies that have their toes unplagued with corns will walk about with you. Welcome, gentlemen! Oh, I have seen the day when I have worn a visor and could tell a whispering tale in a fair lady's ear, such as would please. Tis gone, tis gone, tis gone. Oh, you are welcome, gentlemen. Come, musicians, play!
What lady is that which doth enrich the hand of yonder knight? Oh, she doth teach the torches to burn bright. It seems she hangs upon the cheek of night, like a rich jewel in an Ethiop's ear. Beauty too rich for use, for earth too dear. So shows a snowy dove trooping with crows, as yonder lady o'er her fellow shows. The measure done, I'll watch her place of stand, and touching hers make blessed my rude hand. Did my heart love till now? Forswear it, sight, for I ne'er saw true beauty till this night.
This, by his voice, should be a Montague. Fetch me my rapier, boy! What dares this slave come hither, covered in an antic face, to fleer in scorn at our solemnity? Now, by the stock and honor of my kin, to strike him dead, I hold it not a sin.
Why, how now, cousin? Wherefore storm you so?
Uncle, this is a Montague, our foe.
Young Romeo, is it?
'Tis he, that villain Romeo.
Content thee, gentle cuz. Let him alone. He bears him like a portly gentleman, and to speak truth, Verona brags of him to be a virtuous and well-governed youth. I would not for the wealth of all the town here in my house do him disparagement. Therefore, be patient. Take no note of him.
It fits when such a villain is a guest. I'll not endure him.
He shall be endured. You'll make a mutiny among my guests.
Why, uncle, 'tis a shame.
Go to, go to. You are a saucy boy. Is so, indeed. I'll make you quiet. What cheerly my hearts! Yes!
I will withdraw. But this intrusion shall, now seeming sweet, convert to bitter gall.
If I profane with my unworthiest hand this holy shrine, the gentle sin is this: my lips, two blushing pilgrims ready stand to smooth that rough touch with a tender kiss.
Good pilgrim, you do wrong your hand too much, which mannerly devotion shows in this. For saints have hands that pilgrims' hands do touch, and palm to palm is holy palmers' kiss.
Have not saints' lips and holy palmers too?
Aye, pilgrim, lips that they must use in prayer.
Oh, then, dear saint, let lips do what hands do. They pray, grant thou, lest faith turn to despair.
Saints do not move, though grant for prayer's sake.
Then move not, while my prayer's effect I take. Thus, from my lips by thine, my sin is purged.
Then have my lips the sin that they have took.
Sin from my lips, O trespass sweetly urged, give me my sin again.
Kiss by the book.
Madam, your mother craves a word with you.
What is her mother?
Mary Bachelor, the lady of the house.
Is she a Capulet? Oh, dear account, my life is my foe's debt.
Away, begone, the sport is at the best.
Aye, so I fear, the more is my unrest.
Come hither, nurse. What is yon gentleman?
I know not.
Go ask his name. If he be married, my grave is like to be my wedding bed.
His name is Romeo, and a Montague, the only son of your great enemy.
My only love sprung from my only hate, too early seen unknown, and known too late. Prodigious birth of love it is to me, that I must love a loathed enemy.
Can I go forward when my heart is here? Turn back, dull earth, and find thy center out.
Romeo! My cousin, Romeo! Oh, oh, oh!
He is wise, and on my life hath stolen him home to bed.
He ran this way and leaped this orchard wall. Call, good Mercutio.
Nay, I'll conjure too. Romeo! Humors! A madman! Passion! Lover!
He jests at scars that never felt a wound. But soft, what light through yonder window breaks? It is the east, and Juliet is the sun. Arise, fair sun, and kill the envious moon, who is already sick and pale with grief that thou, her maid, art far more fair than she. Be not her maid, since she is envious. Her vestal livery is but sick and green, and none but fools do wear it. Cast it off. It is my lady. Oh, it is my love. Oh, that she knew she were. She speaks, yet she says nothing. What of that? Her eye discourses. I will answer it. I am too bold. 'Tis not to me she speaks. Two of the fairest stars in all the heaven, having some business, do entreat her eyes to twinkle in their spheres till they return. What if her eyes were there? They in her head? The brightness of her cheek would shame those stars as daylight doth a lamp. Her eyes in heaven would through the airy region stream so bright that birds would sing and think it were not night. See how she leans her cheek upon her hand? Oh, that I were a glove upon that hand, that I might touch that cheek.
I mean...
She speaks! Oh, speak again, bright angel, for thou art as glorious to this night being o'er my head as a winged messenger of heaven unto the white upturned wandering eyes of mortals that fall back to gaze on him when he bestrides the lazy pacing clouds and sails upon the bosom of the air.
Oh, Romeo... Romeo, wherefore art thou, Romeo? Deny thy father and refuse thy name. Or, if thou wilt not, be but sworn my love and I'll no longer be a Capulet.
Shall I hear more? Shall I speak at this?
'Tis but thy name that is my enemy. Thou art thyself, though not a Montague. What's Montague? It is nor hand, nor foot, nor arm, nor face, nor any other part belonging to a man. Oh, be some other name. What's in a name? That which we call a rose by any other word would smell as sweet. So Romeo would, were he not Romeo called, maintain that dear perfection which he owes without that title. Romeo, doff thy name, and for that name which is no part of thee, take all myself.
I take thee at thy word. Call me but love, and I'll be new baptized. Henceforth I never will be Romeo.
What man art thou that thus bescreened in night so stumblest on my counsel?
By a name, I know not how to tell thee who I am. My name, dear saint, is hateful to myself because it is an enemy to thee. Had I it written, I would tear the word.
My ears have not yet drunk 100 words of that tongue's utterance, yet I know the sound. Art thou not Romeo and a Montague?
Neither, fair maid, if either thee dislike.
How camest thou hither? Tell me, and wherefore? The orchard walls are high and hard to climb, and the place death, considering who thou art, if any of my kinsmen find thee here.
With love's light wings did I o'erperch these walls, for stony limits cannot hold love out, and what love can do that dares love attempt. Therefore thy kinsmen are no stop to me.
If they do see thee, they will murder thee.
I have knight's cloak to hide me from their sight. And but thou love me, let them find me here. My life were better ended by their hate than death prorogued wanting of thy love.
Thou know'st the mask of night is on my face. Else would a maiden blush bepaint my cheek for that which thou hast heard me speak tonight. Fain would I dwell on form, fain deny what I have spoke. But farewell compliment. Dost thou love me? I know thou wilt say aye. And I'll take thy word. Yet if thou swear'st, thou mayst prove false. At lovers' perjuries, they say Jove laughs. Oh, gentle Romeo, if thou dost love, pronounce it faithfully, or if thou think'st I'm too quickly won, I'll frown and be perverse and say thee nay, so thou wilt woo. But else, not for the world. In truth, fair Montague, I am too fond, and therefore thou mayst think my havior light. But trust me, gentlemen, I'll prove more true than those that have more cunning to be strange. I should have been more strange, I must confess, but that thou overheard'st, ere I was ware, my true love's passion. Therefore, pardon me, and not impute this yielding to light love, which the dark night hath so discovered.
Lady, by yonder blessed moon, I swear that tips with silver all these fruit treetops.
Oh, swear not by the moon, the inconstant moon that monthly changes in her circled orb, lest that thy love prove likewise variable.
What shall I swear by?
Do not swear at all. Or, if thou wilt, swear by thy gracious self, which is the god of my idolatry, and I'll believe thee.
If my heart's dear love...
No, well, do not swear. Although I joy in thee, I find no joy in this contract tonight. It is too rash, too unadvised, too sudden, too like the lightning which doth cease to be, ere one can say it lightens. Sweet good night. This bud of love by summer's ripening breath may prove a beauteous flower when next we meet. Good night. Good night. A sweet repose and rest come to thy heart as that within my breast.
Oh, wilt thou leave me so unsatisfied?
What satisfaction canst thou have tonight?
The exchange of thy love's faithful vow for mine.
I gave thee mine before thou didst request it, and yet I would it were to give again.
Wouldst thou withdraw it? For what purpose, love?
But to be frank and give it thee again. And yet I wish but for the thing I have. My bounty is as boundless as the sea, my love as deep. The more I give to thee, the more I have, for both are infinite. I hear some noise within. Dear love, adieu. Anon, good nurse. Sweet Montague, be true. Stay but a little, I will come again.
Oh, blessed, blessed night! I am afeard, being in night, all this is but a dream, too flattering, sweet to be substantial.
3 words, dear Romeo, and good night indeed. If that thy bent of love be honorable, thy purpose marriage, send me word tomorrow by one that I'll procure to come to thee, where and what time thou wilt perform the rite, and all my fortunes at thy foot I'll lay and follow thee, my lord, throughout the world.
Madam!
I come anon, but if thou meanst not well, I do beseech thee.
Madam!
By and by I come to cease thy suit and leave me to my grief. Tomorrow will I send.
So thrive my soul.
1,000 times good night.
1,000 times worse to want thy light. Love goes toward love as schoolboys from their books, but love from love toward school with heavy looks.
Romeo!
It is my soul that calls upon my name. How silver sweet sound lovers' tongues by night, like softest music to attending ears.
Romeo!
My dear!
What o'clock tomorrow shall I send to thee?
At the hour of 9.
I will not fail. 20 years till then. I have forgot why I did call thee back.
Let me stand here till thou remember it.
I shall forget to have thee still stand there, remembering how I love thy company.
And I'll still stay to have thee still forget, forgetting any other home but this.
'Tis almost morning. I would have thee gone, and yet no further than a wanton's bird who lets it hop a little from her hand, like a poor prisoner in his twisted gyves, and with a silk thread plucks him back again, so loving jealous of his liberty.
I would I were thy bird.
Sweet, so would I. Yet I should kill thee with much cherishing. Good night. Good night. Parting is such sweet sorrow that I shall say good night till it be morrow.
Not really sure how to feel about it.
The gray-eyed morn smiles on the frowning night, checkering the eastern clouds with streaks of light. Oh, mickle is the powerful grace that lies in herbs, plants, stones, and their true qualities. For not so vile that on the earth doth live, but to the earth some special good doth give. Within the infant rind of this weak flower, poison hath residence and medicine power. For this being smelt with that part cheers each part, being tasted slays all senses with the heart. 2 such opposed kings encamp them still in man as well as herbs, grace and rude will.
Good morrow, father!
Benedicite, what early tongue so sweet saluteth me. Young son, it argues a distempered head so soon to bid good morrow to thy bed. Or if not so, then here I hit it right. Our Romeo hath not been in bed tonight.
The last is true, the sweeter rest was mine.
God pardon sin, wast thou with Rosaline?
With Rosaline, my ghostly father, no. I have forgotten that name and that name's woe.
That's my good son, but where hast thou been then?
I'll tell thee ere thou asked me again. I have been feasting with mine enemy, where on a sudden one hath wounded me, that's by me wounded. Both are remedies within thy help and holy physic lies.
Be plain, good son, and homely in thy drift. Riddling confession finds but riddling shrift.
Then plainly know my heart's dear love is set on the fair daughter of rich Capulet. As mine on hers, so hers is set on mine, and all combined save what thou must combine by holy marriage. When and where and how we met, we wooed and made exchange of vow. I'll tell thee as we pass, but this I pray, that thou consent to marry us today.
Holy Saint Francis, what a change is here. Is Rosaline, whom thou didst love so dear, so soon forsaken? Young men's love then lies not truly in their hearts, but in their eyes. And art thou changed? Pronounce this sentence then. Women may fall when there's no strength in men.
Thou chidest me off for loving Rosaline.
For doting, not for loving, pupil mine.
And bad'st me bury love.
Not in a grave to lay one in, another out to have.
I pray thee, chide me not. Her I love now, doth grace for grace and love for love allow. The other did not so.
Oh, she knew well, thy love did read by rote, but could not spell. But come, young waverer, come go with me. In one respect I'll thy assistant be. For this alliance may so happy prove to turn your household's rancor to pure love.
Oh, let us hence, I stand on sudden haste.
Wisely and slow, they stumble that run fast.
Where the devil should this Romeo be? Came he not home tonight?
Not to his master's. I spoke with his man.
Ah! That same pale, hard-hearted wench, that Rosaline, torments him so that he will sure run mad.
Tybalt, the kinsman of old Capulet, hath sent a letter to his father's house.
A challenge on my life.
Romeo will answer it.
Any man that can write may answer a letter.
Nay, he will answer the letter's master how he dares, being dared.
Alas, poor Romeo. He is already dead, stabbed with a white wench's black eye, run through the ear with a love song. Ugh. The very pin of his heart, cleft with the blind bowboy's butt shaft. Oh. And is he a man to encounter Tybalt?
Why, what is Tybalt?
More than Prince of Cats, I can tell you. Oh, he is the courageous captain of compliments. He fights as you sing prick song. Keeps time, distance, and proportion. He rests his men on rest. One, two, and the third in your bosom. The very butcher of a silk button, a duelist.
Ah, here comes Romeo. Here comes Romeo. Mwah.
Signor Romeo, bonjour. There's a French salutation to your French slop. You gave us the counterfeit fairly last night.
Good morrow to you both. What counterfeit did I give you?
The slip, sir, the slip. Can you not conceive?
Pardon, good Mercutio, for my business was great, and in such a case as mine, a man may strain courtesy.
That's as much to say. A case such as yours constrains a man to bow in the hands.
Meaning to curtsy?
Thou hast most kindly hit it.
A most courteous exposition.
Nay, I am the very pink of courtesy.
Pink for flower?
Right.
Why, then, is my pump well flowered?
Sure wit. Follow me this jest now till thou hast worn out thy pump. That when the single soul of it is worn, the jest may remain after the wearing soul singular.
Oh, single soul jest, solely singular for the singleness.
Come between us, good Benvolio, my wits faint.
God ye good morrow, gentlemen.
God ye good den, fair gentlewoman.
Is it good den?
'Tis no less, I can tell you. For the body hand of the dial is now upon the prick of noon.
Out upon you? What a man are you?
One gentlewoman that God hath made for himself to mar.
By my troth, it is well said, for himself to mar, quotha. Can any of you gentlemen tell me where I may find the young Romeo?
I can tell you. But young Romeo will be older when you have found him than he was when you sought him. I am the youngest of that name, for fault of a worse.
If you be he, sir, I desire some confidence with you.
Oh, she will indict him to some supper.
A bod. So, Romeo, will you come to your father's wheel to dinner, thither?
I will follow you.
Farewell, ancient lady. Farewell.
Mary, farewell. I pray you, sir, what saucy merchant was this who was so full of his ropery?
A gentleman, nurse, that loves to hear himself talk and will speak more in a minute than he will stand to in a month.
And you speak anything against me, and I'll take him down, and I were lustier than he was, and 20 such jacks. And if I cannot, I'll find those that shall, scurvy knave. I pray you, sir, a word. My young lady bade me inquire you out. What she bade me say, I will keep to myself. But first, I must tell you, if you should lead her into a fool's paradise, as they say, it would be a very gross kind of behavior, as they say, for the gentlewoman is young, and therefore, if you should deal double...
Nurse, commend me to thy lady and mistress, I protest unto thee.
Oh, good heart, and if faith, I shall tell her as much. Lord, she will be a joyful woman.
What wilt thou tell her, nurse? Thou dost not mark me.
I will tell her, sir, that you do protest, which, as I take it, is a very gentlemanlike offer.
Bid her devise some means to come to shrift this afternoon, and there she shall at Friar Lawrence's cell be shrived and married. Here is for thy pains.
Oh, no, truly, sir, not a penny.
Go to, I say you shall.
This afternoon, sir? She will be there.
And stay, good nurse, behind the abbey wall. Within this hour my man shall be with thee. Farewell. Be trusty, and I'll quit thy pains. Farewell, commend me to thy mistress.
Aye, 1,000 times.
Clock struck 9 when I did send the nurse. In half an hour she promised to return. Perchance she cannot meet him. That's not so. Oh, she is lame. Love's herald should be thoughts, which 10 times faster glide than the sun's beams. Now is the sun upon the highmost hill of this day's journey, and from 9 till 12 is 3 long hours, yet she is not come.
Had she affections and warm youthful blood, she would be as swift in motion as a ball. My words would bandy her to my sweet love and his to me. But old folks, many feign as they were dead. Unwieldy, slow, heavy, and pale as lead. Oh, God, she comes. Oh, honey nurse, what news? Hast thou met with him? Now, good, sweet nurse. Oh, Lord, why look'st thou sad? Though news be sad, yet tell them merrily. If good, thou shamest the music of sweet news by playing it to me with so sour a face.
I am aweary. Give me leave a while. Fie, my bones ache. What a jaunt have I had.
I wouldst thou hadst my bones and I thy news. Nay, come, I pray thee, speak. Good, good nurse, speak.
Yea, Sue, what haste? Can you not stay a while? Do you not see that I am out of breath?
Ugh. How art thou out of breath when thou hast breath to say to me that thou art out of breath? The excuse that thou dost make in this delay is longer than the tale thou dost excuse. Is thy news good or bad? Answer to that. Say either, and I'll stay the circumstance. Let me be satisfied. Is good or bad?
Well, you have made a simple choice. You know not how to choose a man, Romeo. No, not he. Though his face be better than any man's, and his leg excels all men's, and for a hand and a foot and a body, though they be not to be talked on, yet they are past compare. Oh, he is not the picture of courtesy, but I'll warrant him as gentle as a lamb. Go, wench, serve God. Have you dined at home?
No, but all this did I know before. What says he of our marriage? What of that?
Lord, how my head aches. Oh, what a head have I. It beats as it would be fall in 20 pieces. Oh, my back. Oh, the other side. Oh, my back, my back.
Sweet, sweet, sweet nurse, tell me what says my love.
Oh, your love says like an honest gentleman and a courteous and a kind and a handsome, and I warrant a virtuous. Where is your mother?
Where is my mother? Why, she is within. Where should she be? How oddly thou repliest. Your love says, like an honest gentleman, where is your mother?
God's lady, dear, are you so hot? What? Come up, I trow. Henceforward, do your messages yourself.
Here's such a coil. Come, what says Romeo?
Have you got leave to go to shrift today?
I have.
Then hie you hence to Friar Lawrence's cell. There stays a husband to make you a wife. Now comes the wanton blood up in your cheeks. They'll be in scarlet straight at any news. Hie you to the church. I must another way to fetch a ladder by which your love must climb a bird's nest soon when it is night. I am the drudge and toil in your delight, but you shall bear the burden soon when it is night. Hie, henceforth to the cell.
Hie to high fortune, honest nurse, farewell.
So smile the heavens upon this holy act, that after hours with sorrow chide us not.
Amen, amen. But come what sorrow can, it cannot countervail the exchange of joy that one short minute gives me in her sight. Do thou but close our hands with holy words, then love devouring death, do what he dare. It is enough I may but call her mine.
These violent delights have violent ends, and in their triumph die like fire and powder which as they kiss consume. The sweetest honey is loathsome in his own deliciousness, and in the taste confounds the appetite. Therefore love moderately, long love doth so. Too swift arrives as tardy as too slow. Here comes the lady, oh so light of foot, will ne'er wear out the everlasting flint. A lover may bestride the gossamer that idles in the wanton summer air and yet not fall. So light is vanity.
Good even to my ghostly confessor.
Romeo shall thank thee, daughter, for us both.
As much to him, else is his thanks too much.
Ah, dear Juliet, if the measure of thy joy be heaped like mine, and that thy skill be more to blazon it, then sweeten with thy breath this neighbor air, and let rich music's tongue unfold the imagined happiness that both receive in either by this dear encounter.
Conceit more rich in matter than in words, brags of his substance, not of ornament. They are but beggars that can count their worth, and my true love has grown to such excess I cannot sum up some of half my wealth.
Come to it, and we will make short work. For by your leaves you shall not stay alone till Holy Church incorporate two in one.
I pray thee, good Mercutio, let's retire. The day is hot, the Capulet's abroad, and if we meet, we shall not scape a brawl. For now these hot days is the mad blood stirring.
Thou art like one of those fellows that when he enters the confines of a tavern, claps me his sword upon the table and says, Gad, send me no need of thee. And by the operation of the second cup, draws it on the drawer, when indeed there is no need.
Am I like such a fellow?
Come, come. Thou art as hot a jack in thy mood as any in Italy. Thy head is as full of quarrels as an egg is full of meat, and yet thy head hath been beaten as idle as an egg for quarreling. Thou hast quarreled with a man for coughing in the street because he hath wakened the dog that lay asleep in the sun. And thou wilt tutor me from quarreling.
By my head, here come the Capulets.
Ugh, by my heel, I care not.
Gentlemen, good den. A word with one of you.
And but one word with one of us? Couple it with something. Make it a word and a blow.
You shall find me apt enough to that, sir, and you will give me occasion.
Could you not take some occasion without giving?
Mercutio, thou consorts with Romeo.
Consort? What? Dost thou make us minstrels, and thou make minstrels of us? Look to hear nothing but discords. Here's my fiddlestick. Here's that shall make you dance. Consort.
We talk here in the public haunt of men. Either withdraw into some private place and reason coldly of your grievances, or else depart. Here all eyes gaze on us.
Men's eyes were made to look, and let them gaze. I will not budge for no man's pleasure, I.
Well, peace be with you, sir. Here comes my man.
But I'll be hanged, sir, if he wear your livery.
Romeo, the love I bear thee can afford no better term than this. Thou art a villain.
Tybalt, the reason that I have to love thee doth much excuse the appertaining rage to such a greeting. Villain am I none. Therefore, farewell. I see thou knowest me not.
Boy, this shall not excuse the injuries that thou hast done me. Therefore, turn and draw.
I do protest I never injured thee, but love thee better than thou canst devise till thou shalt know the reason of my love. And so, good Capulet, which name I tender as dearly as my own, be satisfied.
Oh, calm, dishonorable, vile submission. Tybalt, you rat catcher, will you walk?
What wouldst thou have with me?
Good king of cats, nothing but one of your nine lives that I mean to make bold withal. And as you shall use me hereafter, dry beat the rest of the eight.
I am for you.
Gentle Mercutio, put thy rapier up.
Come, sir, your passado.
Draw, Benvolio, beat down their weapons. Gentlemen, for shame, forbear this outrage. Tybalt, Mercutio, the prince expressly hath forbidden bandying in Verona's streets. Ha! Ha! Hold on, Tybalt! Good Mercutio! No.
I am hurt. A plague of both your houses. Oh, I'm sped. Is he gone and hath nothing?
What? Art thou hurt?
A scratch. Mary, 'tis enough.
Courage, man, the hurt cannot be much.
No, 'tis not so deep as a well, nor so wide as a church door. But 'tis enough. Oh, 'twill serve. Ask for me tomorrow, and you shall find me a grave man. I am peppered, I warrant, for this world. A plague of both your houses! Zounds, a dog, a rat, a mouse, a cat to scratch a man to death. A braggart, a rogue, a villain that fights by the book of arithmetic. Why the devil came you between us? I was hurt underneath your arm.
I thought all for the best.
Help me to some house, good Benvolio, or I shall faint.
The plague of both your houses. They have made worm's meat of me. I have it and sell me too. Your house is...
Miss Gentleman, the prince's near ally, my very friend, hath gotten his mortal hurt in my behalf. My reputation stained with Tybalt's slander. Tybalt, but an hour hath been my kinsman. Oh, sweet Juliet, thy beauty hath made me effeminate, and in my temper softened valor's steel.
Oh, Romeo! Romeo, brave Mercutio's dead! That gallant spirit hath aspired the clouds, which too untimely here did scorn the earth!
This day's black fate on more days doth depend. This but begins the woe, others must end!
Here comes the furious Tybalt back again!
Alive in triumph, and Mercutio slain, away to heaven, respective lenity and fire-eyed fury be my conduct now! Now, Tybalt! Take the villain back again that late thou gavest me. For Mercutio's soul is but a little way above our heads, staying for thine to keep him company. Either thou, or I, or both must go with him.
Thou wretched boy that did consort him here, shout with him hence.
This shall determine that.
Oh, Romeo! Away! Be gone! The citizens are up, and Tybalt slain! Stand not amazed! The prince will doom thee death if thou art taken! Hence, be gone! Away!
Oh, I am fortune's fool!
Gallop apace, you fiery-footed steeds, towards Phoebus' lodging. Such a Wagner as fainted would whip you to the west and bring in cloudy night immediately. Spread thy close curtain, love-performing night, that Romeo may leap to these arms untalked of and unseen. Come, night. Come, Romeo. Come, thou day in night. For thou wilt lie upon the wings of night, whiter than new snow on a raven's back. Come, gentle night. Come, loving black-browed knight, give me my Romeo, and when he shall die, take him and cut him out in little stars, and he will make the face of heaven so fine that all the world will be in love with night and pay no worship to the garish sun. Oh, I have bought the mansion of a love but not possessed it, and though I am sold, not yet enjoyed. So tedious is this day as is the night before some festival to an impatient child that hath new robes and may not wear them. Oh, here comes my nurse, and she brings news, and every tongue that speaks but Romeo's name speaks heavenly eloquence. Ay me, what news? Why dost thou wring thy hands?
Oh, well-a-day, he's dead. He's dead, he's dead! We are undone, lady, we are undone! Alack the day, he's gone, he's killed, he's dead!
Can heaven be so envious?
Romeo can, though heaven cannot. Romeo... Romeo, who would ever have thought it, Romeo?
What devil art thou that dost torment me thus? This torture should be roared in dismal hell. Hath Romeo slain himself? Say thou but I, and that bare vowel I shall poison more than the death-darting eye of cockatrice. I am not an eye, if there be such an eye. Or those eyes shut that make thee answer I. If he be slain, say aye, or if not, no. Brief sounds determine of my weal or woe.
I saw the wound. I saw it with mine eyes. Here in his manly breast, God save the mark. A piteous corpse, a bloody, piteous corpse, pale, pale as ashes, all bedaubed in blood, all in gore. Blood, I swooned at the sight.
Break my heart, poor bankrupt, break at once.
Oh, Tybalt. Tybalt, the best friend I had, oh, courteous Tybalt, oh, honest gentleman, that ever I should live to see thee dead.
Is Romeo slaughtered and is Tybalt dead? My dearest cousin and my dearer lord, then dreadful trumpet sound the general doom for who is living if those two are gone.
Tybalt is gone and Romeo.
Romeo banished. Romeo that killed him, he is banished.
Oh, God. Did Romeo's hand shed Tybalt's blood?
It did. It did. Alas, the day it did.
Oh, serpent heart hid with a flowering face. Oh, nature, what hast thou to do in hell when thou didst bower the spirit of a fiend in mortal paradise of such sweet flesh? Was ever book containing such vile matter so fairly bound? Oh, that deceit should dwell in such a gorgeous palace!
No faith, no trust, no honesty in men. All perjured, all forsworn, all not, all dissemblers, shame come to Romeo.
Blistered be thy tongue for such a wish. He was not born to shame. Upon his brow shame is ashamed to sit. What would a beast was I to chide at him?
Will you speak well of him that killed your cousin?
Shall I speak ill of him that is my husband? But wherefore, villain, didst thou kill my cousin? That villain cousin would have killed my husband. Back, foolish tears, back to your native spring. All this is comfort. Wherefore weep I then? Some word there was, worser than Tybalt's death that murdered me. I would forget it fain, but oh, it presses to my memory like damned guilty deeds to sinners' minds. Tybalt is dead, and Romeo banished. That banished. That one word, banished, hath slain 10,000 Tybalts. Tybalt's death was woe enough if it had ended there. But with the rearward following Tybalt's death, Romeo is banished! To speak that word is father, mother, Tybalt, Romeo, Juliet, all slain, all dead. Romeo is banished. There is no end, no limit, measure, bound in that word's depth. No words can that woe sound. Where is my father and my mother, nurse?
Weeping and wailing over Tybalt's corpse. Will you go to them? I'll bring you thither.
Wash they his wounds with tears. Mine shall be spent when theirs are dry for Romeo's banishment. He made you for a highway to my bed, but I, a maid, die maiden and widowed. Come, nurse, come, death! I'll to my wedding bed and death, not Romeo, take my maidenhead.
Hie to your chamber. I'll find Romeo to comfort you. I wot well where he is. Hark ye, Romeo will be here at night. I'll to him. He's hid at Laurence's cell.
Oh, find him. Give this ring to my true knight and bid him come to take his last farewell.
Father, what news? What is the prince's doom?
A gentler judgment vanished from his lips, not body's death, but body's banishment.
Banishment? Be merciful, say death, for exile hath more terror in his look, much more than death. Do not say banishment.
Hence from Verona art thou banished. Be patient, for the world is broad and wide.
There is no world without Verona walls, but purgatory, torture, hell itself. Hence banished, it is banished from the world, and world's exile is death. If banished, thou cuttest my head off with a golden axe, and smilest upon the stroke that murders me.
O deadly sin, O rude unthankfulness, thy fault our law calls death. But the kind prince, taking thy part, hath rushed aside the law and turned that blackward death to banishment. This is dear mercy, and thou seest it not.
'Tis torture, and not mercy. Heaven is here, where Juliet lives. And every cat and dog and little mouse, every unworthy thing, live here in heaven and look on her. But Romeo may not. More validity, more honorable state, more courtship lives in carrion flies than Romeo. They may seize on the white wonder of dear Juliet's hand and steal immortal blessing from her lips, but Romeo may not. He is banished. Flies may do this, but I from this must fly. They are free men, but I am banished. And sayest thou yet that exile is not death?
Thou fond madman, hear me a little speak.
Thou canst not speak of that. Thou dost not feel. Wert thou as young as I, Juliet, thy love, an hour but married, Tybalt, murdered, doting like me, and like me banished? Then mightst thou speak. Then mightst thou tear thy hair and fall upon the ground as I do now, taking the measure of an unmade grave.
Arise, one knocks. Good Romeo, hide thyself.
Not I.
Hark how they knock. Who's there? Romeo, arise, thou wilt be taken. Stay a while. Stand up, run to my study. By and by. God's will, what simpleness is this? I come, I come. Who knocks so hard? Whence come you? What's your will?
I come from Lady Juliet.
Welcome, then.
Holy friar, oh, tell me, holy friar, where may I find my lady's lord? Where is Romeo?
There on the ground with his own tears made drunk.
Stand up. Stand up. Stand and be a man for Juliet's sake. Oh, for her sake, rise and stand.
Speakest thou of Juliet? How is it with her? Doth she not think of me an old murderer? Now I have stained the childhood of our joy with blood removed but little from her own. Where is she? And how doth she? And what says my concealed lady to our cancelled love?
Oh, well, sir, she says nothing, but weeps and weeps, and now falls on her bed, and then starts up, on Tybalt calls, and then on Romeo cries, and then down falls again.
As if that name, shot from the deadly level of a gun, did murder her, as that name's cursed hand murdered her kinsman. Oh, tell me, friar, tell me in what vile part of this anatomy doth my name lodge. Tell me that I may sack the hateful mansion.
Hold thy desperate hand. Hast thou slain Tybalt? Wilt thou slay thyself and slay thy lady too, that in thy life lies by doing damned hate upon thyself? What roused thee, man? That Juliet is alive, for whose dear sake thou wast but lately dead. There art thou happy. Tybalt would kill thee. But thou slewst Tybalt. There art thou happy too. The law that threatened death becomes thy friend and turns it to exile. There art thou happy. A pack of blessings lights upon thy back. Go, get thee to thy love as was decreed. Ascend her chamber hence and comfort her. But look, thou stay not till the watch be set. For then thou canst not pass to Mantua, where thou shalt live till we can find a time to blaze your marriage, reconcile your friends, beg pardon of the prince, and call thee back with 200,000 times more joy than thou went forth in lamentation. Romeo is coming.
I'll tell my lady you will come.
Do so, and bid my sweet prepare to chide.
Oh, hie you, sir. A ring she bade me give you, sir. Hie you hence. Make haste, for it grows very late.
Oh, how well my comfort is revived by this.
Give me thy hand. 'Tis late. Farewell. Good night.
But that a joy past joy calls out on me. It were a grief so brief to part with thee. Farewell.
Things have fallen out, sir, so unluckily that we have had no time to move our daughter. Look you, she loved her kinsman Tybalt dearly. So did I. Well, we are born to die. 'Tis very late. She'll not come down tonight.
These times of woe afford no time to woo. Madam, good night. Commend me to your daughter.
I will, and know her mind early tomorrow morning. Tonight she is mewed up to her heaviness.
Sir Paris, I will make a desperate tender of my child's love. I think she will be ruled in all respects by me. Nay more, I doubt it not. Wife, go you to her ere you go to bed. Acquaint her here of my son Paris' love, and bid her, mark you me, on Wednesday next. But soft, what day is it?
Monday, my lord.
Monday. Wednesday is too soon. A Thursday let it be. A Thursday, tell her she shall be married to this noble earl. Therefore we'll have some half a dozen friends and there an end. But what say you to Thursday?
My lord, I would that Thursday were tomorrow.
Well, get you gone. A Thursday be it then. Farewell, my lord. Light to my chamber, ho. Good night.
Wilt thou be gone? It is not yet near day. It was the nightingale and not the lark that pierced the fearful hollow of thine ear. Nightly she sings in yon pomegranate tree. Believe me, love, it was a nightingale.
It was the lark, the herald of the morn, no nightingale. Look, love, what envious streaks do lace the severing clouds in yonder east. Night's candles are burnt out, and jocund day stands tiptoe on the misty mountaintops. I must be gone and live, or stay and die.
Yon light is not daylight, I know it, I. It is some meteor that the sun exhales to be to thee this night a torchbearer and light thee on thy way to Mantua. Therefore stay yet, thou needst not to be gone.
Let me be ta'en, let me be put to death. I am content so that will have it so. I have more care to stay than will to go. Come, death, and welcome, Juliet wills it so. How is it, my soul? Let's talk, it is not day.
It is. Hi, hence be gone. Away is the lark that sings so out of tune, straining harsh discords and unpleasing sharps. Oh, now be gone, for more light and light it grows.
More light and light, more dark and dark our woes.
Madam!
Nurse?
Your lady mother is coming to your chamber. The day is broke. Be wary, look about.
Then window, let day in and let life out.
Oh, farewell, farewell. One kiss and I'll descend.
Art thou gone so, love? Lord, I, husband, friend, I must hear from thee every day in the hour, for in a minute there are many days.
I will omit no opportunity that may convey my greetings, love, to thee.
Thinkst thou we shall ever meet again?
I doubt it not. And all these woes shall serve for sweet discourses in our time to come.
Oh God, I have an ill-divining soul. Methinks I see thee now thou art below as one dead in the bottom of a tomb. Either my eyesight fails or thou look'st pale.
And trust me, love, in my eyes so do you. Dry sorrow drinks our blood. Adieu, adieu.
Oh, daughter, are you up?
Who is the cause? Is it my lady mother?
Why, how now, Juliet?
Madam, I am not well.
Evermore weeping for your cousin's death. What, wilt thou wash him from his grave with tears? And if thou couldst, thou couldst not make him live, therefore have done. Some grief shows much of love, but much of grief shows still some want of wit.
Yet let me weep for such a feeling loss.
Well, girl, thou weep'st not so much for his death as that that villain lives which slaughtered him.
What villain, madam?
That same villain, Romeo.
Aye, madam. From these the reach of my hands would none but I might venge my cousin's death.
We will have vengeance for it, fear thou not. Thou wilt be satisfied, then weep no more. Now, girl, I tell thee joyful tidings. Well, well, thou hast a careful father-child, one who, to put thee from thy heaviness, hath sorted out a sudden day of joy that thou expects not, nor I looked not for.
And, madam, in happy time, what day is that?
Mary, child, early next Thursday morn, at the gallant young and noble gentleman, the county Paris, at St. Peter's Church, will happily make thee there a joyful bride.
Now, by St. Peter's Church and Peter, too, he shall not make me there a joyful bride. I wonder at this haste that I must be wed ere he that should be husband comes to woo. I pray you, tell my lord and father, madam, I will not marry yet, and when I do, I swear it shall be to Romeo, whom you know I hate, rather than marry Paris. This is news indeed.
Well, here comes your father. Tell him so yourself, and see how he will take it at your hands.
Why, how now, a conduit girl? What, still in tears? Evermore showering? How now, wife? Have you delivered to her our decree?
Aye, sir, I have, but she will none. She gives you thanks. I would the fool were married to her grave.
Soft, take me with you. Take me with you. How will she none? Does she not give us thanks? Is she not proud? Does she not count her blessed, unworthy as she is, that we have wrought so worthy a gentleman to be her bridegroom?
Not proud that you have, but thankful that you have. Proud can I never be of what I hate, but thankful even for hate that has meant love.
How now, how now? Chop logic, what's this? Proud! And I thank you, and I thank you not, and yet not proud. Mistress Minion, you. Thank me no thankings, nor proud me no prouds, but fettle your fine joints against Thursday next to go with Paris to St. Peter's Church, or I will drag thee on a hurdle thither. Out, green sickness carrion! Out, you baggage, you tallow face!
Fie, fie, what are you, mad?
Father, I beseech you on my knees, hear me with patience, but to speak a word.
Hang thee, young baggage! Disobedient wretch, I tell thee what? Get thee to church at Thursday, or never after look me in the face. Speak not, reply not, do not answer me, my fingers itch.
Wife, we scarce thought us blessed that God hath lent us but this only child. But now I see this one is one too much, and we have a curse in having her out on her hilding.
God in heaven bless her. You are to blame, my lord, to rate her so.
Peace, you mumbling fool. Utter your gravity or a gossip's bowl, for here we need it not.
You are too hot.
God's bread. It makes me mad. Day, night, hour, tide, time, work, play, alone and in company. And still my care hath been to have her matched. And having now provided a gentleman of noble parentage, proportioned as one's thoughts would wish a man, and then to have a wretched puling fool, a whining mammoth, in her fortune's tender, answer me, I'll not wed, I cannot love, I am too young, I pray you pardon me. But as you'll not wed, I'll pardon you. Graze where you will. You shall not house with me. Look to it. Think on't. I do not use to jest. Thursday is near. Lay hand on heart, advise. And you be mine, I'll give you to my friend. And you be not, hang, beg, starve, die in the streets, for by my soul I'll ne'er acknowledge thee, nor what is mine shall never do thee good. Trust to it, bethink you, I'll not be forsworn.
There are no pity sitting in the clouds that sees into the bottom of my grave. Oh, sweet, my mother cast me not away. Delay this marriage for a month, a week, or if thou wilt not, if you do not, make the bridal bed in that dim monument where Tybalt lies.
Talk not to me, for I'll not speak a word. Do as thou wilt, for I have done with thee.
Oh, God. Oh, nurse, how shall this be prevented? My husband is on earth, my faith in heaven. Alack, alack that heaven should practice stratagems upon so soft a subject as myself. What sayst thou? Hast not thou a word of joy? Comfort me, counsel me, some comfort, nurse.
Faith, here it is. Romeo is banished in all the world to nothing, that he ne'er dares come back to challenge you, or if he do, it must needs be by stealth. Then, since the case so stands as now it doth, I think it best you married with the county. Oh, he's a lovely gentleman. Romeo's a dishclout to him. An eagle, madam, hath not so fair, so green, so quick an eye as Paris hath. Oh, beshrew my very heart, I think you are happy in this second match, for it excels your first. Or, if it didn't, your first is dead, or 'twere as good he were as living here, and you no use of him.
Speakest thou from thy heart?
And my soul, too, or else beshrew them both.
Amen.
What?
Well, thou hast comforted me marvelous much. Go in and tell my lady that I am gone, having displeased my father, to Lawrence cell to make confession and to be absolved.
Mary, I will, and this is wisely done.
Ancient damnation! Oh, most wicked fiend! Is it more sin to wish me thus forsworn, or to dispraise my lord with that same tongue which she hath praised him with above compare so many thousand times? Go, counselor, thou and my bosom henceforth shall be twain. To the friar to know his remedy. If all else fail, myself have power to die.
Collecting names of...
On Thursday, sir, the time is very short.
Well, my father Capulet will have it so, and I am nothing slow to slack his haste.
You say you do not know the lady's mind. Uneven is the course. I like it not.
Immoderately she weeps for Tybalt's death. Therefore have I little talked of love. For Venus smiles not in a house of tears. Now, sir, her father counts it dangerous that she doth give her sorrow so much sway, and in his wisdom hastes our marriage to stop the inundation of her tears. Now do you know the reason of this haste?
I would I knew not why it should be slowed. Look, sir, here comes the lady towards myself.
Huh. Happily met, my lady and my wife.
That may be, sir, when I may be a wife.
That may be, must be, love, on Thursday next.
What must be shall be.
That's a certain text.
Come you to make confession to this father?
To confess to that, I should confess to you.
Do not deny to him that you love me.
I will confess to you that I love him.
So will ye, I'm sure, that you love me.
If I do so, it will be of more price being spoke behind your back than to your face.
Poor soul, thy face is much abused with tears. Thy face is mine, and thou hast slandered it.
Maybe so, sir, for it is not mine own. Are you at leisure, holy father, now, or shall I come to you at evening mass?
My leisure serves me, pensive daughter, now. My lord, we must entreat the time alone.
God shield, I should disturb devotion. Juliet, on Thursday early will I rouse thee. Till then, adieu, and keep this holy kiss.
Oh, shut the door, and when thou hast done so, come weep with me, past hope, past cure, past help.
Oh, Juliet, I already know thy grief. It strains me past the compass of my wits. I hear thou must, and nothing may prorogue it, on Thursday next be married to this county.
Tell me not, friar, that thou hearest of this, unless thou tell me how I can prevent it. If in thy wisdom thou canst give no help, do thou but call my resolution wise. And with this knife I'll help it presently. God join my heart in Romeo's. Thou our hands. And ere this hand, by thee to Romeo sealed, shall be the label to another deed. Give me some present counsel, or behold, be not so long to speak. I long to die if what thou speak not of remedy.
Hold, daughter, I do spy a kind of hope, which craves as desperate an execution as that is desperate which we would prevent. If, rather than to marry County Paris, thou hast the strength of will to slay thyself, then is it likely thou wilt undertake a thing like death to chide away the shame, that copest with death himself to escape from it, and if thou darest, I'll give thee remedy.
Oh, bid me leap rather than marry Paris off the battlements of any tower, or shut me nightly in a charnel house, and I will do it without fear or doubt to live an unstained wife to my sweet love.
Hold then, go home, be merry, give consent to marry Paris. Wednesday is tomorrow. Tomorrow night, look that thou lie alone. Let not thy nurse lie with thee in thy chamber. Take thou this vial, being then in bed, and this distilling liquor drink thou off, when presently through all thy veins shall run a cold and drowsy humor. For no pulse, no warmth, no breath shall testify thou livest. The roses in thy lips and cheeks shall fade to paly ashes. Thy eyes' windows fall like death when he shuts up the day of life. And in this borrowed likeness of shrunk death thou shalt continue 42 hours, and then awake as from a pleasant sleep. Now, when the bridegroom in the morning comes to rouse thee from thy bed, there art thou dead. Thou shalt be borne to that same ancient vault where all the kindred of the Capulets lie. In the meantime, against thou shalt awake, shall Romeo by my letters know our drift, and Romeo bear thee hence to Mantua.
Give me, oh, tell not me of fear.
Hold, get you gone. Be strong and prosperous in this resolve. I'll send a friar with speed to Mantua with my letters to thy lord.
Love, give me strength, and strength shall help afford. Farewell, dear father.
Why, how now, my headstrong? Where have you been gadding?
Where I have learned me to repent the sin of disobedient opposition to you and your behests, and to beg your pardon. Pardon, I beseech you. Henceforward, I am ever ruled by you.
Why, I am glad on't. This is well. Stand up. This is as should be.
Nurse, will you go with me into my closet to help me sort such needful ornaments as you think fit to furnish me with tomorrow?
No, not till Thursday. There's time enough.
Go, nurse. Go with her. We'll to church tomorrow.
We shall be short in our provisions. 'Tis now near night.
Tush! I will stir about, and all things shall be well, I warrant thee, wife. Go thou to Juliet. Help to deck up her. I'll not to bed tonight. Let me alone. Oh! I will play the housewife for this once. what ho! Oh, they are all forth. Ah, I will walk myself to County Paris to prepare him up against tomorrow. My heart is wondrous light since this same wayward girl is so reclaimed.
Aye, those attires are best. But I pray thee, gentle nurse, leave me to myself tonight, for I have need of many orisons to move the heavens to smile upon my state, which, well, thou knowest, is cross and full of sin.
What? Hurry busy home, need you my help?
No, madam. So please you let me now be left alone, and let the nurse this night sit up with you, for I am sure you have your hands full all in this so sudden busyness.
Oh, good night. Get thee to bed and rest, for thou hast need.
Farewell. God knows when we shall meet again. I have a faint, cold fear thrills through my veins and almost freezes up the heat of life. I'll call them back again to comfort me. Nurse! What should she do here? My dismal scene, I needs must act alone. Come, vial. What if this mixture do not work at all? Shall I be married then tomorrow morning? No. No. This shall forbid it. Lie thou there. What if it be a poison which the friar subtly hath ministered to have me dead, lest in this marriage he be dishonored because he married me before to Romeo? I fear it is. And yet methinks it should not, for he hath still been tried a holy man. How if, when I am laid into the tomb, I wake before the time that Romeo come to redeem me? There's a fearful point. Shall I not, then, be stifled in the vault, to whose foul mouth no healthsome air breathes in, and there die strangled ere my Romeo comes? Or if I live, is it not very like the horrible conceit of death and night together with the terror of the place? Oh, look, methinks I see my cousin's ghost seeking out Romeo that did spit his body upon a rapier's point. Stay, Tybalt, stay! Romeo. 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 This do I drink to thee.
Come, stir, stir, stir. The second cock hath crowed. Go waken Juliet. Go and trim her up. I'll go and chat with Paris. Make haste, her bridegroom. He has come already. Make haste, I say.
Mistress, mistress, what, Juliet? Fast, I warrant her, she. Needs must wake you. Madam, madam, madam. What, dressed and in your clothes and down again? Alas. Alas, help! Help! My lady's dead! Oh, well, a day that I was born! Some aqua vitae, ho! My lord, my lady!
What noise is here?
A lamentable day!
What is the matter?
Look, look, oh, heavy day!
Homie? What? Homie? My child, my only life! Revive! Look up, or I will die with thee! Help! Call help!
For shame, bring Juliet forth. Her lord has come.
She's dead. Deceased. She's dead. Oh, alack the day.
Alack the day. She's dead. She's dead. She's dead.
Let me see her. Alas. She is cold. Her blood is settled and her joints are stiff. Life and these lips have long been separated.
Death lies on her like an untimely frost on the sweetest flower of all the fields.
A lamentable day!
A woeful time!
Death that hath ta'en her hence to make me wail ties up my tongue and will not let me speak. All things at the ordained festival turn from their office to black funeral. Our instruments to melancholy bells, our wedding cheer to sad burial feasts, our solemn hymns to sullen dirges change
our bridal flowers serve for a buried corpse, and all things change them to the contrary.
If I may trust the flattering truth of sleep, my dreams presage some joyful news at hand. I dreamt my lady came and found me dead. Strange dream that gives a dead man leave to think, and breathed such life with kisses in my lips that I revived and was an emperor. Ah, me, how sweet is love itself possessed when but love's shadows are so rich in joy. News from Verona, how now, Balthazar? Dost thou not bring me letters from the friar? How doth my lady? Is my father well? How fair is my Juliet? That I ask again, for nothing can be ill if she be well.
Then she is well and nothing can be ill. Her body lies in Capel's monument and her immortal part with angels lives. I saw her laid low in her kindred's vault and presently took post to tell it you. Oh, pardon me for bringing these ill news, since you did leave it for my office, sir.
Is it even so? Then I defy you, stars! Thou knowest my lodging. Get me ink and paper and hire post horses. I will hence tonight. Leave me and do the thing I bid thee do. Hast thou no letters to me from the friar?
No, my good lord.
No matter. Get thee gone and hire those horses. I'll be with thee straight. Well, Juliet, I will lie with thee tonight. Let's see for means. Oh, mischief, thou art swift to enter in the thoughts of desperate men. I do remember an apothecary, and hereabouts he dwells, which late I noted in tattered weeds, with overwhelming brows, culling of simples. Meager were his looks. Sharp misery had worn him to the bones. And in his needy shop a tortoise hung, an alligator stuffed, and other skins of ill-shaped fishes. And if a man did need a poison now, whose sale is present death in Mantua? Here lives a caitiff wretch would sell it him. Oh, the same thought did but forrun my need, and this same needy man must sell it me. As I remember, this should be the house. What ho, apothecary!
Who calls so loud?
Come hither, man. I see that thou art poor. Hold, there is 40 ducats. Let me have a dram of poison, such soon speeding gears will disperse itself through all the veins that the life-weary taker may fall dead.
Such mortal drugs I have, but Mantua's law is death to any he that utters them.
Art thou so bare, and full of wretchedness, and fearest to die? Famine is in thy cheeks, need and oppression starveth in thine eyes, contempt and beggary hangs upon thy back. The world is not thy friend, nor the world's law. The world affords no law to make thee rich. Then be not poor, but break it and take this.
My poverty, but not my will, consents.
I pay thy poverty and not thy will.
Put this in any liquid thing you will, and drink it off, and if you had the strength of 20 men, it would dispatch you straight.
There is thy gold. Worse poison to men's souls, doing more murders in this loathsome world than these poor compounds that thou mayst not sell. I sell thee poison. Thou hast sold me none. Farewell. Buy food and get thyself in flesh. Come, cordial and not poison. Go with me to Juliet's grave, for there must I use thee.
Welcome from Mantua. What says Romeo? Or if his mind be writ, give me his letter.
Oh, going to find a barefoot brother out, one of our order, to associate me here in this city, visiting the sick, and finding him. The searchers of the town, suspecting we both were in a house where the infectious pestilence did reign, sealed up the doors and would not let us forth. So that my speed to Mantua there was stayed.
Who bear my letter then to Romeo?
Oh, I could not send it. Oh, here it is again. Nor get messenger to bring it thee, so fearful were they of infection.
Unhappy fortune! By my brotherhood, the letter was not nice, but full of charge, of dear import, and the neglecting of which may do much danger. Friar John, go hence!
Sweet flower, with flowers thy bridal bed I strew. Oh, woe. Thy canopy is dust and stones, which with sweet water nightly I will do, or wanting that with tears distilled by moans. The obsequies that I for thee will keep nightly shall be to strew thy grave and weep. What cursed foot wanders this way tonight? To cross my obsequies in true love's right? What? With a lamp? Muffle me night a while.
Hold. Take this letter. Early in the morning, see thou deliver it to my lord and father. Give me the light. Upon thy life I charge thee, whatever thou hearest or seest, stand aloof and do not interrupt me in my course.
I will be gone, sir, and not trouble you.
So shalt thou show me friendship. Take thou that, live, and be prosperous. And farewell, good fellow.
This is the banished haughty Montague that murdered my love's cousin. With which grief it is supposed, the fair creature died. Stop thy unhallowed toil, vile Montague. Can vengeance be pursued further than death? Condemned villain, I do apprehend thee. Obey and go with me, for thou must die.
I must indeed, and therefore came I hither. Good, gentle youth, tempt not a desperate man. Put not another sin upon my head by urging me to fury. Oh, be gone! By heaven, I love thee better than myself, for I come hither armed against myself. Stay not! Be gone, live, and hereafter say a madman's mercy bade thee run away.
I do defy thy conjurations and apprehend thee as a felon here.
Wilt thou provoke me? Then have at thee, boy!
Oh! I am slain. If thou be merciful, open the tomb. Lay me with Juliet.
Oh, give me thy hand. One writ with me in sour misfortune's book. I'll bury thee in a triumphant grave. A grave? Oh no, a lantern slaughtered youth. For here lies Juliet, and her beauty makes this vault a feasting presence full of light. Death, lie thou there by a dead man interred. Oh, my love. My wife. Death that had sucked the honey of thy breath hath had no power yet upon thy beauty. Thou art not conquered. Beauty's ensign yet is crimson in thy lips and in thy cheeks, and death's pale flag is not advanced there. Oh, dear Juliet, why art thou yet so fair? Shall I believe that unsubstantial death is amorous, and that the lean, abhorred monster keeps thee here in dark to be his paramour? For fear of that, I will stay with thee, and never from this palace of dim night depart again. Here. Here will I remain with worms that are thy chambermaids. Oh, here will I set up my everlasting rest and shake the yoke of inauspicious stars from this world-wearied flesh. Eyes, look your last. Arms, take your last embrace. And lips, oh, you the doors of breath, seal with a righteous kiss a dateless bargain to engrossing death. Come, bitter conduct. Come, unsavory guide, thou desperate pilot, now at once run on the dashing rocks thy seasick, weary bark. Here's to my love. Oh, true apothecary, thy drugs are quick. Thus, with a kiss, I die.
What's here? A cup closed in my true love's hand. Poison, I see it in its timeless end. Oh, churl, drunk all and left no friendly drop to help me after. I will kiss thy lips. Haply some poison yet doth hang on them to make me die with a restorative.
Mm.
lips are warm. Oh, happy dagger. This is thy sheath.
Seal up the mouth of outrage for a while, till we can clear these ambiguities and know their spring, their head, their true descent. And then will I be general of your woes and lead you even to death. Meantime, forbear. Let mischance be slave to patience. This letter doth make good the friar's words, their course of love, the tidings of her death. And here he writes he did by poison of a poor apothecary, and therewithal come to this vault to die and lie with Juliet. Where be these enemies? Capulet, Montague, see what a scourge is laid upon your hate, that heaven finds means to kill your joys with love. And I, for winking at your discords, too, have lost a brace of kinsmen. A glooming peace this morning with it brings. The sun, for sorrow, will not show his head. Go hence to have more talk of these sad things. Some shall be pardoned, and some punished. For never was a story of more woe than this of Juliet and her Romeo.
I did my best, but it wasn't much. I could have your soul, I tried to touch. I told the truth, I didn't come to fool you. And even love.